What's that, sir?
Why didn't your boss bring up the call that you overheard? The reason you're here today. I mean, you're their closing witness, yet their star witness, their first witness, Ambassador Taylor, didn't even bring it up. And when we deposed you, you said this was extremely distinctive experience, one of the most remarkable events of my life. You described it like this. You said, after the call happens, I immediately told Deputy Chief of Mission and others at the embassy about the call. Then you said you went on vacation. You told several friends and family about the call. Then you come back on August 6th, and you tell Ambassador Taylor about the call. And then in your deposition statement, you said in your statement today as well, I repeatedly referred to the call in meetings and conversations where the issue of the president's interest in Ukraine was relevant. I repeatedly referred to the call in meetings and conversations where the issue of the president's interest in Ukraine was relevant. That sounds like government speak for you told everybody. Yet their star witness, their first witness, Ambassador Taylor, when he came here, he related 13 different conversations he had between July 18th when the aid is frozen, September 11th when it's released. 13 different conversations, never once mentioning this call. July 19th, Dr. Hill, Colonel Vindman told Taylor what Sondland told them. July 19th, Sondland told Taylor about the upcoming Trump-Zelensky call. July 20th, Sondland told Taylor what Sondland told Zelensky to tell Trump. July 20th, Dana Luke tells Taylor what Zelensky told Dana Luke. July 28th, Morrison tells Taylor what happened on the Trump-Zelensky call. August 16th, Volker tells Taylor what Yarmak told Volker. August 21st, Breckbull talks to Taylor. August 22nd, Morrison talks to Taylor. August 29th, Yarmak talks to Taylor. September 1st, Morrison tells Taylor what Sondland told Morrison about what Yarmak told Sondland. September 2nd, Morrison tells Taylor what Dana Luke told Morrison. September 7th, Morrison tells Taylor what Sondland told Trump. And September 8th, Sondland tells Taylor what Trump told Sondland. Nowhere, nowhere is there... Is there a Holmes tells Taylor what the President of the United States told Sondland?
May I answer 13 that question?
Conversations. Yeah, I'll get to you. I'll give you a chance here in a second. But 13 conversations from their star witness. You're their closing witness. And he can't remember a call from a guy he works with every single day. Why?
Yes, sir. So immediately when I went back to the embassy after this this lunch on the 26th, I told my direct supervisor, the deputy chief of mission, I would have told Ambassador Taylor immediately, except he was on the front lines that afternoon. I then went on, as I testified, my vacation on Saturday, came back the following Monday, and on Tuesday, I was back in the ambassador's office where I referred to the call in that week plus that I was away. It was my assumption that the deputy chief of mission would have informed other people about the call as well. So my recollection is when I did refer to the call in that meeting that Ambassador Taylor nodded knowingly as though he had been briefed on it. So I referred to the call and I mentioned some of my takeaways from the call. And at the time, the main takeaway from the call was the president doesn't care about Ukraine. So we're going to have a tough road ahead to convince him that it's important enough for him to schedule an Oval Office meeting for President Zelensky and ultimately to release this hold on security assistance. That was the takeaway. And that's what I referred to repeatedly in the coming weeks whenever it became relevant. And I'll remind you, sir, that one more important point. Throughout this time, as I testified, we were trying to find a formula, things we could do with Ukrainians that would convince the president that they were worth talking to.
Maybe Mr. Holmes, the takeaway was he thought it was no big deal because he already knew. He didn't remember because we already had the transcript. We had the Trump Zelensky transcript had been out for 2 months.
So I believe that when
even though you're repeatedly bringing this conversation up, as you said to everybody, anytime there's a talk about Ukraine, you recall this conversation. Maybe it was the transcript. The call happened on the July 25th. That's 4 months ago. The transcript's been out for 2 months. Maybe the ambassador thought this is nothing new here. But Shazam, last week you come forward with supposed this new information. There is nothing different in there than what we had on the transcript. Maybe that's the reason their star witness, their first witness, didn't bring it up. But they had to have something. So you're their closing witness because you overheard the president talking to Ambassador Sondland.
Sir, if I could answer, I see 4 seconds left on the clock. I believe
Mr. Holmes, you may take as long as you need.
Thank you, sir. I believe that Ambassador Taylor did already know when I briefed him when I returned from vacation on the 6th. It was not news to him. that the president was pressing for a Biden investigation.
That's not what I asked. I asked why he didn't share with us.
Well, Jordan, Mr. Jordan, please do not interrupt the witness any further. Mr. Holmes,
this is exactly
Mr. Jordan's time has expired, but yours is not.
Okay, thank you,
sir. You may answer the question.
It's exactly my point. I brief the call in detail of the deputy chief of mission, went away for a week, come back, I refer to the call, and everyone is nodding. Of course that's what's going on. Of course the president is pressing for a Biden investigation before he'll do these things the Ukrainians want. There was nodding agreement. So did I go through every single word in the call? No, because everyone by that point agreed. It was obvious what the president was pressing for. And Ambassador Taylor, as you just outlined, had all those other interactions.
But he didn't share it with us.
Mr. Jordan, please do not interrupt.
But sir, my vivid recollection of an event I was involved with was a touchstone experience that to me validated
and
what
sir, Mr. Jordan, could, please
what we believed. And Ambassador Taylor was not in that call.
And so all of a sudden last week, you got to come
Mr.
tell
Jordan,
us, right?
Mr. Jordan, you know your boss will allow the witness to answer the question.
I'll finish with this.
Thank you.
He was involved in a number of other interactions, as you've outlined, that brought him to the same conclusion. It is quite possible that
he doesn't share the one that
Mr.
The guy
Jordan,
he
Mr.
With.
Jordan,
he doesn't share
Mr.
That
Jordan,
one.
You may not like the witness's answer, but we
no,
will hear it.
There wasn't an answer.
Mr. Jordan, we will hear the witness's answer. Have you concluded, Mr. Holmes?
I have, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Himes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, Dr. Hill, Mr. Holmes. Thank you for your testimony. Dr. Hill, you made a fairly dramatic comment in your opening statement to which the ranking member took some exception. I'm more interested in the Ukraine piece of this, but you said some of you on this committee appear to believe that Russia and its security services did not conduct a campaign against our country and that perhaps somehow, for some reason, Ukraine did. I'm really much more interested in the Ukraine piece of this, but I do want to defend you briefly. I don't know what my colleagues believe, but I do have a pretty good sense of what the effects are of creating ambiguity, of lacking clarity and conviction around the Russian attack on the election of 2016.
Fuzzy Mouser, you're good at it.